I'm Jonnie Becker, I'm from Charles City High School, and we have just started a one-to-one environment this year. Learning is an adventure, but it's also a risky adventure for a lot of students, and the computer gives them a safe place to kind of crawl in and hang out, and then you can talk to them virtually and they'll ask you questions or ask for help in a way that they would never walk up to you and ask for help. So I find that I can customize things for students a lot easier by just keeping an eye on them and letting them work through the virtual. Also, class is never over, like the bell rings, but class isn't over. We have a learning management system. We use Edmodo school-wide, and the students then know that they can work on their chemistry any place, anytime, anywhere. They have the apps on their phones, they have it on their computer, so I can have a discussion that's going really good in class, and if they want to continue it on through lunch, even though the bell rang, they can keep talking on through lunch if they want. Or they can pick it back up later on in the evening, which is kind of nice, which means your doors are never closed. So that's been really awesome. Also, it opens up a huge variety of resources, so you don't have just one textbook that you rely on to be the sole source and everybody has to do what the book says. Just the other day in class, we were talking about statistics, and we had already talked about at the beginning of the year what central tendency was, but the students didn't remember this end of the year, and they just got on and Googled it, and they started firing out different definitions of central tendency that they had found from different places. So we wrote them all down on the board, and we figured out what we would put them together for ourselves, where normally a textbook would have been opened up, they would have read the definition back, and everybody would have been done talking about it. But since they had a lot of different definitions from a lot of different sources, they thought, okay, there may be more to this story than just what we thought. So it makes sure that they always have access to the information they need. Also, having technology has made sure that we don't have to do things that have already happened or that are not real. We can work on real data or real situations that are happening right now. So we can look at something that just happened in the news or something that somebody just read. For example, we're doing studies of water right now. One of my students was reading on his computer about how they are making billboards in South America that take humidity out of the air and turn it into fresh water. So he and I can work together and really customize things for what's happening now. Well, finding technology is the first thing, and a lot of people think about technology as the hardware. And the hardware is just the first step. So the students already have a really powerful computer in their hands. That's covered. So then you have to just select what kind of software that you want to use with it or what additional add-ins that you think are appropriate. Usually we don't do a whole lot of add-ins unless we're going to use probeware, which is like equipment that you plug into your computer to measure things. For example, we used a spectrophotometer today, which normally that's a huge piece of equipment, but Vanir makes a small one so that plugs right into the computer, so we're going to use that one. I usually like to stick with a company, if I'm going to buy extras, that I know has good customer service and good troubleshooting. So those are huge things when you're buying hardware or trying to decide what hardware to use. When it comes to software, if it's free, give it a try. That's kind of the way I go. If it's not free, I ask for a free trial on anything that I think looks like I might want to use it in my classroom, and they usually oblige. If they say, no, we don't offer any free trial, then that's not a company you want to work with anyway, because they aren't confident enough in their work to give it a test drive. How do I find things that I want to use? Twitter is the number one place that I go, and I find cool technology tools, because anybody who's a real techie is probably going to be tweeting about it on Twitter, because that's where the techie people hang out. So I follow some of the main like EdTech hashtags, and then I kind of search around and be like, oh, that's something I think I might want to use, or that sounds kind of interesting. And then I kind of test drive it. I pretend I'm a student, and I try to do a lab with it, or I try to do an activity, or I'd be like, okay, how would this change what I'm doing in my classroom? If I find something on Twitter that I'm like, that's kind of cool, but I can't think of a way that it would do something I already do in my classroom better, I don't use it. So, for example, sure, there's lots of websites that you can make a concept map about. Great, we use Inspiration already, and I'm trying to think, is there any of the ones online that I've seen for making bubble webs or concept webs online that are better than Inspiration? I haven't seen one that works better, so I'm not going to use a different one just to use a different one. I'm going to use the one that is working and isn't a problem in my classroom. Now, sometimes if you don't have a problem in your classroom you're looking for, it's cool to just check out the things that you find on Twitter and just keep them in your little back parts of your brain. It's like, we know that's out there, but I don't throw it in my classroom until I can find a way that's going to make it better than what I already have. classroom management with technology is interesting, and proactive is way better than reactive. And the students are way more sophisticated than you could ever possibly imagine, and way more creative with their technology than you could imagine, both good and bad. So right up front, teaching your students about digital literacy, teaching them about digital safety, teaching about netiquette, really, really critical. Giving them a computer and its endless capabilities and wide open World Wide Web and never having that discussion first, you're gonna end up in a reactive situation. So even if it takes the first 2 weeks of your class to just have the netiquette discussion and give some examples, commonsense.org has a really great set of digital literacy learning tools, is really, really helpful for the whole entire year. So just starting off that proactive stance. One of the other things that we do is we have a program that monitors the computers. We use Insight, things like remote watch, or there's lots of them out there that you can watch what your students are doing. Use them and use them often so the students know that that is just part of your habit, that you are always kind of watching them and that somebody's kind of always looking over their shoulders and running through the things that they have been doing on their computers. Our students know that their computer's history, every keystroke, everything is monitored. So anything that they type or anything on there can all be traced back to exactly when and where. And all you have to do is have one student test you on that, and you follow through, that the word spreads, that you really are watching, and that computer doesn't belong to them and they have to behave with it. Also, some really simple things like just be active in your classroom. The students are very fast with how they move through their files and their windows. So if you see somebody flipping really quickly through something, pretty sure that they're probably not doing something they're supposed to be doing. So it's really simple to just, you know, say, hey, put your lid down, and you're good to go. Also, I find that sometimes it makes classroom management easier. Students that wouldn't have been engaged in your classroom because they were too scared to talk or too afraid to share something, when you open up their computer and you let them run on the chat stream at the same time, they are then engaged and they're willing to chat. They're not willing to raise their hand for the discussion. So they would have been dinking around or doing something or causing a ruckus, where now they're engaged in the learning because they get to communicate in a safer environment. So it has goods and bads. That is one of the best things about having technology in your classroom, especially having technology and using a learning management system such as Edmodo or Moodle or any of the other ones that are out there in the market. When they turn in something or when they access information on those, it keeps track of all of their actions. So for example, if I put up a reading that I want students to do, it tracks how many students have viewed that reading. If I know if I have 100 kids in the class and only 50 people have viewed it, I know half the class didn't even do the reading. So it changes my lesson plan when I come in the morning and see, okay, did the students access the reading and half of them haven't. So having that information totally changes about how you work your classroom. Also, for example, my kids took a quiz today, and that's put in on Edmodo. They have a reaction to that quiz, so I know their confidence level. Before I even grade it, I can tell if the student was really, really confident. If I look at their work and it's poor quality, but they were really, really confident, that tells me that there's a mismatch between what they personally have assessed themselves at and what they're really capable of, which means we have to do some peer reviewing in my classroom. It's going to change the way I teach. If they came through, they were really confident, and that their scores come through as that they've all done really well, which it automatically analyzes those scores by question, by test, so I can divide it up without having to do all that extra work myself. It just gives me an informed decision that it's faster. Not that I didn't do those things before I had the technology in the kids' hands. It was a lot of hours for me to do that work at home on a spreadsheet, and now that it just pops out the numbers automatically, which is awesome. I do love using a quick poll or a quick vote. There's lots of polling or voting options, just as they walk out of the room after a day. That would be really cool. I've also seen some that you can do live, where a student could enter a poll as you're working or discussing, and it will automatically change as you're working. So if you're giving a lecture and all of your polls come down, be like, okay, we're gonna talk about that part again right now. So you can even do like real-time action data, where that was never possible before. If you're thinking about going to a one-to-one environment, or if you already sort of are, and you don't have a technology integrationist, you need one, and more than one would be highly recommended. We have one right now that is for the high school, and I think she's shared for multiple buildings, and there's just not enough of her to go around. Our district has made sure that she has a phone that gets all of her emails and everything, so even when she's in a classroom, she gets alerts and buzzes if you need something, and she can answer it right there. So having that safety line to go to, that is a district employee, is huge. Some districts have a rat pack or somebody who is a bunch of kids that are good at tech shooting, and they're great to send the students to that don't really know how to run their computer or just kind of beginning to learn their computer. And you want to send them to a group of students that actually know how to use their computer, but that understand that they have to teach somebody in an appropriate way how to use their computer. So if you have a little group of students that you could trust enough to make a little rat pack about our tech squad, that'd be really, really awesome. Also, they give us professional development time every week. Sometimes we talk about what do we want to use to teach digital literacy, what are the Web 2.0 tools that we're working on, what is something that worked, what didn't work. Those kind of things work really handy to get together and kind of chat about them. But also, as long as they encourage that you're getting out to your learning network, that's really important. So even if your district just starts its own Twitter chat or its own Edmodo conversation, or whatever discussion panel you decide to use, so that teachers can just post something that like, hey, I really wish I knew how to upload a PowerPoint, something that simple, or I wish I knew how to make a flash movie. There might be somebody in your district that already knows how to do it. So having some of those live discussions that can happen asynchronously would really, really help. I would say just being really proactive with the policies that you set. So if you set rules for your school and their school usage policies, that you stand behind them. So for example, if a student is caught doing something they're not supposed to be doing on the computer, the consequences need to follow through. Because if you're kind of relaxed on them, that they're going to take a mile of relaxation until you really have to get firm on them. And sometimes they've infected other students with that same bad behavior that you haven't caught yet because you've given them so much leeway. So whatever policies that you actually decide to put into action need to be strongly enforced, just to get everybody consistent. Just some closing things that I have kind of learned along the way is you really have to make your homework or whatever your assessments are original. Everything that is published, the answer key is probably on the web somewhere, and the students will find it, give them enough time. And once they find it, they will share it. So the days of just using that worksheet that came with your textbook are pretty much over, because the answer keys are loaded up somewhere. And it's very, very hard to track them down after they started doing that behavior. And once they know that they can get away with it, they will. So you really need to make your homework or your work something that is original to your classroom and authentic to what you're doing in your room. Also, get really familiar with keystroke shortcuts when it comes to your computer so that you don't have to take over the student's mouse. Their mouse or their trackpad, it kind of becomes their home. And when you start touching that, they don't really like that. But often you can close a program or open a program or copy something or paste something with a keystroke shortcut that just fixes the problem that they've accidentally wandered themselves into and they just need to get back to something they recognize. And that's a really good way to do it. Plus, if they're in some place that they aren't supposed to be, Command Q is a great thing to use on the MacBooks and they barely know what you did and next thing you know, they're back to where they needed to be. Also, a lot of computers come with universal access or accessibility options. And even though your student may not have a disability, they may find some of those options helpful, such as inverting the screen to a black back and a white forwards if they have to work in low light. Some students do their homework very late at night because they work late. So having that option so it's not such a strain on their eyes really helps. Also, some of them have options where that you can have a student dictate and it will type for them, or you can have it read the screen for them. And those are free programs. They come as the accessibility options that most students don't even explore because they don't think they have a handicap, which could be very, very helpful. Especially the Zoom option comes in handy. It's really good for you to model good behavior. So if you want the class to be working on something and you're hanging out on your Twitter stream while they're supposed to be working, they're going to think hanging out on their Twitter stream is okay too. So don't be doing that. Or if you answer your phone in the middle of class, don't be doing that because they're going to leave their phone on in the middle of class. So just be proactive. Students don't often know how to organize their computers very well. Their computers start to look like their lockers sometimes with the desktop. It's just a mess. So showing them how to make folders and how to make files doesn't seem like something that should be part of the curriculum, but it really does, so that they don't accidentally lose that file and not know how to find it. And they're going to lose files on their computers and their devices, so you got to teach them how to use the search agents so they can find them quickly and they won't be like, my computer ate the file. It didn't. You just didn't find it.